doubted.
But of all the faithful that our Lord appeared to, that there was no one who disbelieved. Some doubted for a while, then wavered a little. And so our Lord makes his appearances to console them. First he goes to his mother, the Holy Virgin that they adore us. We know that because even in hymnology we sing, the angel cried to the Lady full of grace, rejoice, O pure virgin. Again I say rejoice, for your son is risen from his 3 days in the tomb. And this is the archangel Gabriel singing to the Virgin Mary that her son Jesus Christ had risen, and then he appeared first to Mary, his mother. Then he appeared to Mary Magdalene, as we hear in the Gospel of John. And then he appeared to the other Myrrh-bearing women who were there at the tomb. And our Lord appeared later that day to the 10 that were gathered there in the upper room. And so the tomb is central. It's central in the mystery of Christ risen from the dead. That this was the biblical place here. And so that's why in the hymnology, we're only singing about the tomb. From the canon of the Holy Gospel, the third oath, come let us drink a miraculous beverage, drawn from a barren stone, not drawn from a barren stone, but rather a new vintage, from the fountain of incorruption, springing from the tomb of Christ, in whom we are established. And of course, the reference there is to Moses. Moses, in the olden times, he hit the rock, and water came from the rock so that the Hebrews had water in the wilderness. So now what the hymnologist is saying is that the tomb of Christ is the fountain of incorruption, that the new vintage, the new beverage comes forth. That's the waters of godliness. So all the glory, all the truth, all the theology, everything that our Lord offers us for our nourishment by virtue of this power. Again we sing, from the tomb thou art shone forth once again, our radiant Sun of Righteousness, S-U-N, Sun of Righteousness, that the light of Christ, it shines forth from the tomb. Again we sing, let us go with lamps in hand to meet Christ, who comes from the tomb like a bridegroom. So the tomb is called the bridal chamber, and Christ comes forth from the tomb as a bridegroom to meet what? To meet the bride. Who's the bride? It's the new people of God, the church, that he comes joyfully to meet us, so that we could enter into the tomb with him. You say, well, he wants to enter into the tomb. Well, we've done that already. That all of us have been in the tomb of Christ. If you don't know that, study Orthodoxy 101. What did the Apostle Paul tell you? What does he tell us in Romans? He says, when we were baptized, weren't you baptized? Okay. When you were baptized, you were baptized. You were buried with him and joined with Christ in his death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the Father's glory, you too might live a new life. You were buried with him. Well, what were you buried in? You were buried in the tomb. What is the tomb of Christ? The tomb of Christ is the baptismal font. What happened? You were drowned. You were immersed. Not with the water sprinkled on you. You were immersed 3 times. You were the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And what was drowned out was the old man. What was drowned out was sinfulness. And what arises anew on the third rising is newness of life. This newness of life, as the Apostle says, that we've been raised from the dead, from the deadness of sinfulness, by virtue of being immersed in the tomb of Christ, which is the baptismal font. And so all of us already experience the tomb of Christ. Because it's the likeness of what we have achieved. If Christ didn't die, if he didn't go into the tomb and he didn't rise again, we would have no newness of life. And it is given to us that newness of life. Christ didn't have to die. He didn't have to be buried. He didn't have to rise from the tomb. But he did it for our sake. And so we, following the pattern of Christ, we've been immersed that the tomb of Christ has become the womb of our birth. We are born as a new people of God. And so this is what it means here. Again, it says, thou didst arise, O Christ, yet the tomb remained sealed, as at thy birth the virgin's womb remained unharmed, and thus thou hast opened up to us the gates of paradise. From the sealed tomb thou dost shine forth, O Christ, and closed doors thou dost come to thy disciples, O Christ God. We sang that last week on the Thomas Christ as a bridegroom comes to marry his people, to marry the new people that he's engaged to, which is the people that will follow him, the bride, the church, we ourselves. That the tomb is the source of light, timeless light, and endless light, the Son of Righteousness who shines forth from him. And they've been talking of this great feast that we sing all the time. Thou dost descend into the tomb of the mortal, and thou dost destroy the power of death. The power of death was destroyed in the tomb. When our Lord went into the tomb, the whole subterranean earth became sanctified. That every grave, every tomb, every sepulcher in the world became sanctified. Because now the seeds of immortality, the seeds of the resurrection of the dead, is planted in every cemetery, in all places in the world, because all the dead will rise again. The cemetery, which means the place of sleep, that the people will rise from the dead on the last day. And so we have all this understanding for us of what the tomb of Christ is. And that's why the altar itself is the tomb of Christ. Oftentimes we don't think of that, but the altar is the tomb of Christ. When we take on the great and holy Saturday, the plashanitsa, the winding sheet of the Lord, what do we do? We place it on the altar for 40 days. It represents the tomb of Christ. And on every Sunday, the first service, which is Saturday evening, what do we do? And we open the gospel book, and the priest stands at the right side of the altar. Not in front of the altar, but at the right side of the altar, and he reads one of the 11 resurrectional gospels. Why the right side? Because in the scriptures it says the angels stood at the right side of the tomb and proclaimed to the myrrh-bearers the good news that Christ had risen from the dead. And so every Sunday, what do? We proclaim Sunday after Sunday, and that's what we talked about, the significance of Sunday as the day of the Lord, the day of the resurrection. But Sunday after Sunday, what do? That the tomb, the altar is the tomb of Christ. And again, we proclaim Christ had risen from the dead. And we sing the hymns, the various hymns. We sing the Evangelii. Blessed art thou, Lord, teach me thy statutes. In the angelic powers, wrath and tomb, the guard of the king is dead man. We sing the hymn of the Myrrh-bearing woman. We process around the church and we come back to the altar. And we sense the altar, the tomb of Christ. And then the holy gospel is read. The cross is central as a sign of victory, power, of salvation, and sanctification in the glory of God. The tomb is just as central for us. We don't think of the altar often as the tomb of Christ, but it is the tomb of Christ. And our Lord tells us that. He says, as often as you eat of this bread, you proclaim my death. As often as you drink of this cup, you proclaim my resurrection. And so the altar is the place where we confess and proclaim the death and resurrection of Christ. Behind the altar is the cross. And on the altar is the body of our Lord, the untimensi. You know what that is, that special holy sheet that was consecrated last year by Archbishop Mike here. And it represents again Christ, the body of Christ, the plashanitsa, Christ in the winding sheet there. And that is always on the altar, so that when we celebrate, we receive the life-giving body and blood of Jesus Christ. The life-giving body and blood of Jesus Christ. In other words, we go back to the tomb. And again, we proclaim, by virtue of receiving Christ risen from the dead, the glory of the resurrection. After we receive the holy gifts, what happens? Well, you don't hear the choir singing something, but the priest goes back into the altar, and the wonderful hymn that we hear sometimes, having beheld the resurrection of Christ, that hymn is said by the priest there. Because again, we've experienced the power of Christ risen from the dead by virtue of receiving the body and blood of Christ. And so all this speaks to us here of the centrality in our faith of the tomb of Christ risen from the dead. And it's the cornerstone of all Orthodox belief. St. Paul says, if Christ hasn't died and risen from the dead, then everything else you hold in your faith, it's of no value, it's meaningless. And so we see the significance of the tomb of Christ. Let us, as we continue to celebrate this holy festival of Christ risen from the dead, celebrate this Sunday and next Sunday and next Sunday and all the Sundays of the age to come, and the evening of our liturgy is resurrectional in that sense. Let us be mindful that we have before us the tomb of Christ. You might not understand it now all the times as a tomb, it just seems like a regular altar. But it's not a regular altar. It brings us into the past, that we ourselves, as the people came to the tomb and saw it empty, and they said, well, nothing's going on here. But there was great power that came from the tomb. Again, the light, the timeless light that shines upon us all. The glory of God, the power of God, the assurance of what we believe in, that it's true. That the tomb is empty. He's not here. We're looking for him. He's not here. He told me he would rise from the dead. He's not here to leave it. And then when our Lord appears to the Myrrh-bearing woman, what does he tell them? He says, rejoice. Be happy. Be glad. I'm risen from the dead. There's newness of life. Walk and be glad in that newness of life. When he appears to the apostles, what does he do? He says, peace be to you. Again, I say, peace be to you. Don't let your heart be troubled. That it's different now, that the tomb is empty, that the glory of God is being made manifest, that I am risen from the dead, that you have newness of life, and walk in that newness of life. Walk in that peace, and be joyful that I am risen from the dead. And so all of us is given to us by our Holy Mother, the Church, so that we continue to be joyful, and continue to contemplate the mystery of Christ risen from the dead. Because it's the very source of our life. And indeed, if we really want to capitalize on it, be more attentive to the Saturday evening service. Because it's the resurrectional service. Every Saturday evening, we have a great opportunity. Who knows what we do on Saturday evenings? But I doubt if that's as great as coming and worshiping our Lord Jesus Christ, Christ risen from the dead. And to hear again those words from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John about Christ risen from the dead, to hear those 11 gospel accounts again. And then the gospel is brought into the center of the church so that we have the opportunity to kiss the icon of the resurrection of Christ on that gospel. And then we sing that wonderful hymn, Heaven Beyond the Resurrection of Christ. And again, we're assured that our faith is real. People, we need to move and be motivated by the power of Jesus Christ risen from the dead. We can't be just simply Orthodox Christians that believe in theoria, of people that don't have the experience and the taste of Christ risen from the dead. And Christ risen from the dead has to be personal for us. We have to experience it. We have to want it. We have to be the joy of being embraced by that power of Christ risen from the dead. And the way to do that is simply by worship and union with Christ, the Lord himself. Christos Celeste.
Christos Celeste.
Christos Celeste.